Okay, in the last video I powered or wired power to all the different components in the enclosure. This included the stepper drivers, the driver board, the variable frequency drive, powering the power supply units, the 12, the 24 and 36 volt power supply units, all via the motor contactor unit, which has a nice juicy on button and off button. In this video I'm going to start wiring stuff to the control board. I'm going to start with the stepper drivers. There are two wiring diagrams in the M542T stepper driver user manual, depending whether the control board you are using uses an active high or low signal. All the gerbil controllers I've come into contact with use a active high signaling, which means the pulse direction enabling wires go to the positive terminals on the stepper drivers. All the ground pins are then wired to a common ground. In my case, these will all go to the PSU because there isn't enough ground ports on the control board. For this video, I'm using a new soldering station sent to me by Banggoods. We made friends again.
Okay. Alright, I've seen one of these before. That's going straight in the bin.
It's a soldering iron heat gun, DC voltmeter and DC power supply all in one. What could go wrong? I'm going to test it out for this build and will provide a link to the item in the description with a few comments. Anyway, the first thing I'm doing is cutting some screen 2-core cable to various sizes to go between the controller and stepper drivers. I expose about 25mm of the 2-core cable on the side which will go to the control board. I strip about 6-8mm of sheathing to expose wire for the boot ferrules. I also put about an inch of heat shrink to neaten the end a little.
Just doing the opposite end now.
On the other side, I soldered a length of green and yellow cable through the screening wire, which I also wrapped in heat shrink. This wire will go to the power ground terminal on the stepper driver and screen or shield the direction and pulse coming into the driver board.
I've just wired a bit of cable between the Z-axis direction and pulse. To the stepper driver. I've also connected a wire to the shielding or the screening, which will eventually go into the ground here. I think that's probably the easiest way of doing it. I still have to connect the enable, which from what I've seen is simply daisy chained along the different stepper drivers. So this is one. It looks like it works okay. I'm hoping I'm not putting too much strain on this joint here, but it looks like it's soldered pretty well on. I'll do the next one now and just show you how I'm doing it. If it doesn't catch when you're trying to strip, just pinch that down with your fingers. This wire is really, really tough. These are the ferrules. I'm using the crimping end on the pliers, which is this bit here. Go more like 22mm up to 25. I do have about a mil and a half of metal kind of exposed. I think I probably could have bought 6mm ones.
I used some offcuts of wire to daisy chain the enable cable between the four stepper drivers and the control board. I used double boot ferrules, which can take two 1mm cables, to daisy chain the small pieces of wire together. I'm now wiring the ground from the negative pulse direction and enable terminals of the stepper drivers to a common ground on the 36 volt power supply unit. The shorter pieces between each driver's terminal are about 5cm long and 9cm between each driver. I also had to cut down the copper strands a little so three wires could fit into the double boot ferrules.
Okay, probably should have done this first. It looks mental. You want to make sure you screw into the flat edge or onto the back of that, not onto the side, because you could loosen the crimp. These panel holes are so make it so much easier to kind of work on things inside the box. Okay, I'm going to mark up the panel which will have the aviation sockets for the stepper drivers and the limit switches. Okay, so this is how I'm going to put the aviation sockets. I've got four with five pins. One of the pins will be where the shielding goes from the wiring outside the case into the case and then to the ground. These three here will be the limit switches. Again, there's one extra pin for grounding the shielding. And then this one here is going to be the probe, and again, one extra pin. Just labelled up what these should be. That panel. And I've got the wire, the four core wire. It's going to. Okay, this is the solder that I've been using to attempt to wire the panel connection aviation sockets. This stuff here I bought from Maplin some time ago, and it's a 1 mil lead free solder, and I am assuming the melting temperature of this is a lot higher than leaded solder, and I've always found this quite difficult to use. With the soldering station I was sent, I also received a bit of solder here. This stuff looks a bit better, it's thinner, it's 0.8 mil, and it actually has some information on it compared to this one. I'm not sure if that's the flux, maybe this is 0.7 flux, I need to check what the CU stands for. 63 SN, 37 PB and 1.2%, I'm assuming 1.2% is the content of flux, and then that's the split between leaded solder and tin maybe. This stuff here from Felder, and this was very expensive, this cost me 23 quid. This stuff has 2% silver as well as lead, and it's also narrower, it's a narrower gauge, it's 0.5 millimeters. It also has a lot more flux, 3.5%. I find this very difficult to use. I'd be curious to try this one and that one. The other thing I'm going to do is change the tip of this soldering iron to something with a wider edge, maybe the one in the middle here.
I cut the outer sheathing for the four core wire going between the stepper driver and aviation socket back about 30 mm and exposed 6 mm of copper wire to solder to.
This is my extraction, it's going all the way out the window.
I really don't like soldering aviation sockets. I think I shaved off an hour since the last time I did this, but it still took several hours to finish and I have more soldering to do in the future. I soldered the wires with the socket on the table and the cable held from above.
Okay, that's a really horrible job.
I then checked all the connections with a voltmeter to make sure nothing would short, and also squirted a massive bit of hot glue between all the terminals for permanent strain relief.
I know you're not meant to do that, and obviously if there's a good reason why you shouldn't do that, please let me know. My current post-soldering marathon, I'd put concrete on this if I can keep it in place.
I also covered my horrible soldering work with a nice bit of heat shrink. I wish I'd used the Weipu panel mounts with screw terminals, but they would have been quite expensive and taken up a lot more space on the enclosure.
Okay, I'm just going to put a bit of cable on the end of the screen or shielding here, and that's going to go into the ground on the stepper drivers.
I use a single cut piece of terminal block to join the screening ground from either side of the stepper driver to a single piece of wire that can fit into the appropriate terminal. So what I'm doing is I'm touching an individual contact on this side, and I'm touching all five pins on the aviation panel mount and just checking if there's any shorts. I've got the A, X, Y and Z going to the panel mounts on this side, and then the opposite ends going to the controller. The spindle enable is daisy chained in the red, and the ground for the pulse, the direction, the enable of all four stepper drivers goes to the ground on the 36 volt power supply unit. I've also ground the screening of the pulse and direction signal wiring from the controller, and the two phases go into the aviation panel mounts. In the next video, I'll wire up the panel mounts for the proximity sensors and their voltage dividers within the enclosure. Since this video, I've also finally figured out how to solder aviation panel mounts, so I'll make a separate video about the method that worked for me and share that with you. Thanks again for watching, and don't forget to sacrifice a thumb to keep the algorithm gods happy.